a hint of optimism from the province's top doctor.
These are all indications that we might be starting to bend the curve a bit.
But while some numbers are going down, another grim trend has emerged. People dying of the virus in their homes. And
this is a temporary measure while we assess the evolving situation.
Canada banning flights from India and Pakistan as COVID-19 cases in the region soar. Details on that and how the South Asian community here is coping with loved ones back home dealing with a deadly third wave. Plus,
simply put, we got it wrong.
An emotional Doug Ford apologizes for moving too quickly on some restrictions while promising a new paid sick leave program. Good evening, I'm Kelda Yoon. A glimmer of hope from Ontario's top doctor today, who says there are early signs case counts of COVID-19 may be plateauing. But this is tempered with another grim new reality. People are now dying from the virus in their own homes. All this as the province and the city continue ramping up efforts to get everyone vaccinated. Our Dahlia Ashri reports.
Some things are plateauing. Some things are dipping down a bit.
Ontario's Chief Medical Officer of Health offering a hint of optimism today.
Our reproductive number, effective, has reduced from 1.2 down to 1.03. These are all indications that we might be starting to bend the curve a bit.
At the same time, another troubling trend has emerged. Adults as young as 30 are now dying from COVID-19 in their own homes, approximately 2 per day over the past 2 weeks.
That is in excess of anything that we saw during wave 1 and over wave 2 as well.
Ontario's chief coroner, Dr. Dirk Heyer, says many were not ignoring their symptoms, but had stable conditions that deteriorated quickly.
These were people that weren't necessarily appearing based upon their symptoms to be needing to go to hospital or an ambulance to be called.
This infectious disease expert says this is very concerning.
Tells us there's something new going on, and it's likely that these are the variants, and the variants are attacking people at a younger age, and the symptoms are rapidly progressing.
And while the province continues to examine the situation, they're reminding everyone to limit mobility and get vaccinated.
If we keep doing that, I'm hopeful that over the weekend, we may see some further plateauing, perhaps.
And medical experts agree vaccinating more people is key. So far, over 4.2 million doses of the vaccine have been distributed in the province. In Toronto, nearly 1 million doses have been administered.
We are literally working day and night.
Toronto Fire Chief Matthew Pegg says the city has the ability to do even more, but
we're only administering a small portion of what we're capable of delivering. The only reason for that is we're simply delivering the vaccine we have. We need more vaccine.
And while Canada won't be getting doses of the AstraZeneca vaccine for the next while, it is set to receive tens of millions of doses from Pfizer, Moderna, and Johnson & Johnson in May and June.
Beginning about a week and a half from now, we're expecting significantly increased doses of vaccine to arrive in our city.
The city says it will continue to focus on getting those in hotspots vaccinated, as well as starting up workplace vaccination clinics. Dahlia Ashri, CBC News, Toronto.
The federal government is banning direct flights to Canada from India and Pakistan for the next 30 days, starting at 11:30 tonight.
This is a temporary measure while we assess the evolving situation and determine appropriate measures going forward. In addition, passengers who depart from India or Pakistan to Canada via an indirect route after 11:30 p.m. Eastern tonight will need to obtain a negative COVID-19 pre-departure test at their last point from departure.
The ban would apply to all commercial and private flights, but cargo flights are still allowed to keep the vaccine and PPE supply going. 35 flights from India with at least one case of COVID-19 aboard have arrived in Canada in the last 2 weeks. The Trudeau government has been under intense pressure to make a move like this by the opposition, and even Premier Doug Ford, who penned a letter with Quebec's premier today, calling for more measures at the airport. Now, the ban is being imposed to deal with concerns about India's rising COVID caseloads and mutations of the coronavirus. But how will that affect residents here? Angelina King has more from health experts and the South Asian community.
There's anxiety at this family-run Indian grocery store in Parkdale. Right now, Simran Ball's dad is in rural India for a family emergency.
We're afraid that he might be stranded there. Everybody's just super anxious, super nervous. Yeah. And they're doing their best to like stay apart. Like my dad hasn't taken his mask off since he's gotten there.
Ball agrees with limiting travel from India, but thinks Canadian citizens should be allowed to fly back. She says when her dad eventually comes home, he'll follow all quarantine rules and then some. Still, she worries this variant will bring even more prejudice against South Asians.
We do fear stigmatization.
It's a pretty harrowing experience in the hospitals right now.
Dr. Kashif Prasada says he's seeing entire families sick with COVID after getting infected by just one international traveler who possibly skirted the rules.
I don't know what to say to them when they're asking, like, how am I going to be okay? Because honestly, I can't tell them. It's just really upsetting me.
He says Ottawa should heavily restrict travel from all hotspot countries, shrink the list of those who qualify for essential travel, and close loopholes when it comes to quarantine restrictions.
We need to slow down the spread of these things as much as possible. Otherwise, we start this pandemic all over again.
In India, morgues and hospitals are out of space. There's not enough oxygen, and many can't access healthcare. There's a lot of misinformation and questions.
How do I use oxygen? How do I use a pulse oximeter? What medicine should I take? You know, people are selling counterfeit packs and going door to door with intravenous medications.
That's why he and other doctors created this infographic to help those in India manage COVID at home.
This is really a guide to hopefully help empower them.
Dr. Chagla says when it comes to whether flights should be banned, it's hard to tell exactly where a traveler is coming from and suggests tougher quarantine restrictions instead.
That's probably the easiest and more global step as compared to just playing whack-a-mole with different flights.
Both doctors say the situation in India is a reminder how important vaccines are, not just in Canada, but globally.
This is not going to end until the world gets vaccinated.
Angelina King, CBC News, Toronto.
Colette Kennedy joins us now with a first look at the forecast. And Colette, still a chill in the air tonight, but that's going to take a turn tomorrow.
Yeah, this very changeable weather that we've been experiencing in April, which again, we remind ourselves completely normal, is taking another turn on us and drastically and dramatically different conditions tomorrow. So as high pressure has been building in, we get to say goodbye to some of the lake effect flurry activity. We do still have a cool night tonight with the clearing skies, but it does mean once the sun comes up, we're looking at sunshine through the day too. Now, there'll be some increase in cloudiness into the afternoon hours, but the temperatures are going to soar with a westerly to southwesterly wind. The next system that's going to move in, that one will begin to have an impact as we go into the weekend. We'll see increasing cloudiness Saturday, but timing-wise, it does move in into the afternoon in southwestern Ontario, but not expected to reach the GTA till we get to the evening or overnight hours. So that timing's pretty good there. Minus one tonight, feeling like minus five tomorrow afternoon. With that sunshine, how about 17 degrees for the high, Kelda?
Thanks, Colette. After nearly a week out of the public eye, the premier stepped back into the spotlight today. Doug Ford apologized to Ontarians for moving too quickly on the restrictions he brought in last week, such as closing playgrounds and giving police the power to pull people over at random, measures he quickly walked back.
I know that some of those measures, especially around enforcement, they went too far. Simply put, we got it wrong. I know we got it wrong. I know we made a mistake. And for that, I'm sorry, and I sincerely apologize.
Meanwhile, after months of the government voting against opposition motions for paid sick days, the premier is promising to bring in a program of his own, a program he says will be worth the wait. But as our Lorenda Redicop tells us, he provided few details.
And we will have the best program anywhere in North America.
Speaking from isolation, the premier's first news conference since his controversial measures last Friday, Doug Ford promised help for essential workers.
It isn't enough to know you can't lose your job. You also need to know you won't lose your income.
He became emotional, saying he knows the pandemic has been tough.
People telling me their stories, the stories that could make you cry, families that haven't been able to hold hand.
Doctors say it's essential workers and their families in that situation the most. Ford blamed the federal government for not offering more for workers in the budget and says the federal sickness recovery benefit isn't good enough.
There is a gap, about 2 to 3 days that no one gets paid, so we're going to be working on that.
But he had few details and didn't say when this could start.
Look, it made me angry.
Fred Hahn represents 280,000 workers with QP Ontario.
He wasted our time. He wasted yet another day. Lives will be lost as a result of his inaction.
Workers had two legislated sick days under the last government. Ford got rid of them when he came to power. This family doctor outlines what she feels workers need.
They know that they're allowed to take a day off sick. They know that they will be paid just the way that they're normally paid. They don't have to fill out any extra forms. They don't have to figure out whether or not they're eligible.
The NDP calculated that before today, the government has opposed paid sick day proposals 20 times since mid-February. The latest vote is one this afternoon, a Liberal private member's bill.
It's the most simple bill. If you look through it, it just says provide 10 paid sick days. That's it. And the government, there's no real hard restrictions on it. So it's a very flexible, easy thing for them to do.
But private members' bills rarely pass, especially when they're not from the ruling party. And this afternoon, the Premier's office sent a statement saying under the Liberal bill, employers would pay. And the government doesn't want businesses footing the bill. We still don't know when the government will reveal its plan. Lorenda Redicomp, CBC News, Toronto.
Still ahead, Toronto police lay out how they will enforce new COVID-19 measures with a focus on large indoor gatherings. Plus, the City of Toronto needed new street sweeper machines, so they put out a tender for bids and awarded a contract to a company that outbid any other by six figures. One problem, that company didn't have any street sweeper machines.
This was a disappointment.
How did this blunder happen? That exclusive story after the break. Starting tonight, the city's police force is ramping up efforts to crack down on illegal gatherings. They formed a task force with the sole responsibility of charging people ignoring the lockdown restrictions.
Every one of our police divisions will have four members that are in on their off days with a supervisor that are dedicated to these types of calls over the next 4 weeks. Our focus here is really the larger gatherings that we keep getting called to.
The new task force is in direct response to the latest restrictions imposed by the province, but police say they will not be handling these calls any differently than they have in the past. The task force just allows them to respond more quickly. Still, civil liberty groups have their concerns, particularly about how people will be policed outdoors, where doctors say risk of transmission is lower.
People fear that they are being surveilled by law enforcement, see the police officers looking at them, trying to figure out if they're violating a stay-at-home order, worried about those interactions. That's not going to contribute to anybody's health.
Police say the plan is for officers to use discretion and to only target larger gatherings that could be putting people at risk. CBC News has learned that the City of Toronto awarded a contract worth over $300,000 to a Bolton-based contractor to clean up our streets. There's just one problem. The contractor can't do the work because they don't have the equipment. Our Jessica Ng has more on the botched deal and the toll it's taking on our health.
There's been a lot more just garbage everywhere I've been finding. Yeah, it's been pretty gross.
Just to sit in a public place and not have garbage and litter everywhere, it's extremely important.
We are the one to pay the bill, so for sure it concerns me, you know, sometimes when I see stuff like that.
If you've noticed a lot of garbage and dirt on Toronto streets this spring, you wouldn't be the only one. City officials inked and botched a $336,000 deal with Raffet General Contractor out of Bolton to clean Toronto streets.
There were four separate contracts. They were going to do the Gardiner and Don Valley Parkway, an area within Scarborough, Etobicoke and York, and of course North York. So they were designated specific areas of high needs, and the city would do the rest.
Raffet outbid the competitors by nearly $100,000 to win the contract, but sources say the company didn't have the 12 vehicles required to do the job.
This was a disappointment. I think we were, there's a lot to learn and to take away from this.
The work by Raffet General Contractor was supposed to take place throughout April, but hasn't even started. Now the city will have to use its own fleet of 30 sweepers to clean over 5,000 roads, including the Gardiner and DVP, which will require overnight closures.
Crews already have nearly a month of work to make up. And it's not just the extra masks, dirt, and PPE on the ground that are concerning. Emily Alfred of the Toronto Environmental Alliance says less visible debris can seriously affect our health.
Soot from exhaust or the construction particulate and dust and all the waste on the street that in a rainstorm will get washed down the storm sewers.
What doesn't get washed into our waterways circulates, adding to air pollution.
All this waste in our lives is really kind of bringing home these issues, these bigger issues of waste and how much waste we have and what we do with it.
Councillor Pasternak now says the city is looking at legal action. In similar legal challenges, companies have been temporarily suspended from bidding on municipal contracts. Jessica Ng, CBC News, Toronto.
Here's a chance in front, scores! A backhand by Wayne Simmons.
Leafs versus Jets tonight in Winnipeg. The Leafs looking for a win after losing the last five games. They came out strong in the first with three goals. Winnipeg also with a strong start, scoring two. Both teams would add goals in the second, but the Leafs would add an empty netter in the third to pad out the lead. They'll end their losing skid and win this one 5-3. Partly cloudy tonight, clearing overnight and making way for some sunshine in the morning. Currently, though, still pretty chilly, 2 degrees downtown, feeling like zero. Let's go back to Colette now with a look at your extended forecast. And Colette, looking forward to some sunshine and the warmer temps that are coming.
Yeah, it's a lovely way to end this week. We started it off pretty good, if those of you can remember. Then that cold spell. All right, still a little chilly tonight in between. And then we warm things up and have a lovely way to end things on Friday. So there's that clearing trend we've been seeing. Bright and warm tomorrow. And then, yeah, the timing with this next system as it comes in right now, at least. I mean, we're a couple days out, but it looks like much of the rain shower activity is going to be overnight Saturday into Sunday morning. So not necessarily wet on the Saturday or Sunday during the day. A little different story into southwestern Ontario, where it moves in a bit sooner. We'll show you that illustrated with the models here in a moment. But these are your daytime highs. Okay, Windsor, you did just a little bit better than what you're seeing across the rest of over into eastern Ontario. 8 degrees there. Elsewhere, kind of a struggle for Toronto to get to even 5 degrees. That high pressure does such a nice job. It's almost like it's just a broom sweeping things out, clearing out our skies. That's why we have the clearer conditions overnight tonight. It does allow the temperature to fall just below freezing. The winds let up a little bit through the overnight, though, so tomorrow morning not as significant in terms of the wind chills that we will have, but they'll be there. And then here comes that increasing cloudiness. A little cloud cover comes in Friday, and then much more as we go Friday night into Saturday. So this is 11 a.m. Saturday, just on the doorstep there, Windsor, and then it begins to roll in here through Saturday evening, crossing the Golden Horseshoe, and then into Sunday morning. Look at this. We should actually begin to dry out. Not going to get a whole lot of clearing with the cloud cover, but it will be improving the conditions through the day on Sunday. Tonight, -2, Windsor feeling like -7, Leamington -2 as well. Slightly cooler there for Sarnia and London at -3, but not cool tomorrow afternoon with those highs into the upper teens. You will see some increasing afternoon cloud here, a little more dense than what we'll have over here towards the Golden Horseshoe with these numbers. Okay, that wind chill slightly more significant for Markham and towards Oshawa, but otherwise for Toronto, -5 tomorrow morning. As those winds shift a little bit tomorrow, that helps with these temperatures to pop those up. Where you're getting a wind off the water, though, I kept the temperature down a degree or two. Saturday, 14, there comes the rain, 10 degrees Sunday and Monday, and yes, you see it on Tuesday. It looks like we're going to see a spike again in our temperatures, Kelda.
Thanks, Colette.
The weather is brought to you by Trane, the most reliable heating and cooling brand. We test, so it runs. It's hard to stop a train.
The entire world is going to be affected and is affected by our climate crisis, and it's going to take all of us together to fight it.
On this Earth Day, climate change issues have forced people all around the world to consider their environmental footprint. Coming up, how the younger generation is leading the charge. Stay with us.
I'm Ismaila Alpha, host of Metro Morning. Well, daily case counts of COVID are high and only expected to rise in the near future. ICUs are seeing more patients than they've seen at any point in time during this pandemic. So, well, what can we do now to curb the situation in Toronto? Coming up on tomorrow's program, Mayor John Tory joins me to tackle all of that. Join me weekdays from 5:30 till 8:30 for Metro Morning on CBC Radio 1.
Finally, tonight on Earth Day, we tend to reflect on what it means to be environmentally conscious. Maybe you pick up litter and remember to reduce, reuse, and recycle. But climate change issues have forced people all around the world to consider much more. As our Ali Shiasan reports, it's the younger generation that continues to lead the charge.
It's Earth Day, and like anything good in the last year or so, it's going to look a little different. We're not going to see the big groups of people out in the park picking up litter so much, but that doesn't mean the activism isn't happening.
Take the example of 16-year-old climate activist Aaliyah Herjee.
Right now, we're in a climate crisis, and there needs to be larger action taken, and that action is collective action.
She's an organizer of Fridays for Future, a movement of young people inspired by Greta Thunberg's galvanizing speech calling out the lack of action on the climate crisis.
How dare you!
Herjee says now is actually a great time to educate oneself.
A lot of Earth Day events are online and, you know, there aren't any protests or strikes happening right now, but it's a great way to get involved and to just immerse yourself in the climate activist space.
Individual actions, litter cleanup, reduce, reuse, recycle, all of that, great. But time is running out to reverse course or mend climate change. And so Herjee says we must look at it through a justice lens and hold politicians accountable.
You should be voting with climate action at the forefront of your mind.
And there is the opportunity for environmental activists to really push the federal government on implementing policy to meet the challenges that they say that they want to meet.
It's the younger generations who live with the effects of climate change the longest, so.
Youth have a right to be furious at the inaction of most of the leaders around the world, and they should be yelling and screaming and organizing and protesting to the best of their abilities.
This Earth Day, Herjee would like to see people thinking about it not so much as an annual thing, but more as a pursuit of climate justice 365 days a year.
The entire world is going to be affected and is affected by our climate crisis, and it's going to take all of us together to fight it.
Ali Shiasan, CBC News, Toronto.
And that's our show for you tonight. Thank you so much for watching. Your next local newscast is tomorrow at 6. I will see you back here tomorrow night at 11. Good night.